for your word is a lamp unto our feet. Let the word that we will hear this morning not be an enticing word of a man, but let it be the word of God that will bring glory to thy holy name in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. We thank you, Lord. We worship you. We exalt to magnify you.
Amen.
In Jesus' mighty name we pray.
Amen.
Brethren, you may be seated this morning. It is wonderful to be in the presence of God after a very, very long week. The devil is a liar. Hallelujah.
Amen.
The devil has lost it again. Amen.
Amen.
And he continues to lose. Every time the devil thinks to himself that he can keep us bound, we move higher. We always go higher in life. We don't go below. Sometimes you might not know that you are moving forward. You think that you are still in a particular place because of what you can see. The Bible says that the things that we are seeing physically, the things we can touch with our hands, the things we can see with our eyes, they are temporal. But the things that we cannot see, they are eternal. It's not the day that a child is born. Was that child born? That child had been born donkey years. Many of us, before we came to earth, we have been in the bowels of God maybe a million years. You know, that's why when I see some people start to argue on earth, when a child become a child, is it from the day the father and the mother come together, or when the child becomes a fetus in the womb, or when the sperm comes out, where is that time that the child becomes a human being? Some say by conception, some say when the child is being conceived. But all those theories is false. Because the Bible makes us to know that before you were even talked about to be sent to the world, you have been somewhere. If you have a Bible, let's open to the book of Jeremiah. That's not where we are going, but I want to make a point today. So that we don't look at ourselves as just human beings, but as a special creation by God. Every situation that you are in life, God has prepared you for that thing, prepared you for that job, prepared you for that family, prepared you for that situation. God knew that you would be able to overcome. Look at Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 5. I don't know why God is taking us here this morning, but by the end of the day, we shall know why. He said, "Before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee, and before thou cometh forth out of the womb, I sanctified thee, and I ordained thee a prophet unto nations." Before, that means before you were formed in the belly, before there was a coming together between a man and a woman, Jeremiah had been in existence. Jeremiah was saying, "God, I can't do it. Oh, I'm a small boy. I'm very young. I can't become this. I can't go and preach. I don't know nobody. I've not been ordained." All this kind of complaint. God said, "Come on, Jeremiah, listen to me. Before your father and mother even knew themselves, I have made you a prophet." So that means Jeremiah existed somewhere. Look at it again, verse 5. "Before I formed thee," before I formed thee in the belly. That means before the belly, there was Jeremiah somewhere. He said, "Before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee. And before thou comest forth out from the womb, I sanctified thee. And I ordained thee a prophet unto nations." He's not just going to be a prophet international, nations. He's not going to be a local prophet. So, you are more than what you think about yourself. Before you can make judgment of yourself rationally or irrational, or start to think about yourself based on the history of your family, or based on the place where you come from, or based on your race and color, or based on your eloquence and status, or based on your education, you have to think, who was I before I was sent to this home? to this family, to this community, to this people. Where was I? How has God created me? What was my purpose in life before I became who I thought I am now? What have I been before now? In the spirit, what was my mission? Because God is trying to reaffirm what has been done. That means what we do in ordination on earth is to fulfill all righteousness. That means God said, before you became a prophet, I have already ordained you a prophet unto many nations. Before you preach, you have been preaching before. Before you become anything, I have made that thing happen. In the spirit, we don't know how long it was before it came to pass that Jeremiah have to see himself now as somebody that cannot do it. And God said, you have been doing this thing before. Just go back and do what you know how to do. Because I will be with you. Hallelujah. Today, we will talk about choices in life. Life is choice. Everything about life is a choice we make. God was trying to give Jeremiah the opportunity to make a better choice of himself. Because Jeremiah would have said, no, what you said, I'm not part of it. I didn't know what we were talking about, so I'm not going to do it. We might not even see this verse of the Bible. We might not even have the book of Jeremiah. Because it's not everybody that God called went and did the work. Some people, the Bible said, Jesus said, a sower goes about sowing seed. And some fell by the wayside. And the heat of the sun beat them, they could not survive and they died. There was a seed there, but the seed could not make it. Some fell on thorns. And the thorns could not, they could not expand because there was a lot of weeds and other things that would not let the seed grow. The seed died. Some fell on a rocky soil. And not even, they don't have any soil to follow. They were just sitting on the rock. And the sun dealt with them and they died. But some fell on the fertile ground. And that one that fell on the fertile ground will just go in and get enough moisture and manure, and they will start to grow and become a plant that will come and see, wow, this is a nice tree. But there are many other trees that have been sown that did not make it. So every time God will see somebody that say, yes, I will do it, there are many, many people that said no. Don't be interested on how many people that said no in your life. Because you just need 1 year from God. A word from God will change your life.
Well, thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Just one word. Amen.
I'm not interested in the people that does not believe on the thing that God has put upon our lives. But what I'm interested is on the few people that saw the glory of God and say, yes, amen, we can. And they go about and do what God wants them to do and become successful. Life is choice. But I'm going to give you options in life today. And we are going to talk about what, how God called a man and how you will go and walk in the purpose of God and become the fullness of who God has called you to be. Let me tell you something. The choice to be significant is much better than the choice to be successful. Everybody wants to be successful in life. Even fools can make money and be successful and have fame. And when they die, they just go by the wayside and nobody remember them. But when you are significant, even while you are no more there, most of the people we talk about in the Bible today, they were not the only people that made money or had name in their time. But because they affected humanity, they were very, very significant in life. That even many, many years after they have gone, the story about them will live on. They will still be alive. God told David, said, if all kings die, you, David, will not die. He said, you shall live forever. Up till death, the Jews celebrate David. King David is a feast of the Jews. And they still celebrate him as somebody that lived. Because this is the man that God said, every king will die, but David will not die. He will live forever. Legacy. It was a choice. If David made the choice not to do what God asked him to do, we couldn't have heard about him today. Life is choice.
Amen.
What choice are you making? The Bible says, I've set before you life and death. He said, choose life that you might live. I'm going to talk about this in reference to the Bible. Let's go to the book of Romans chapter 12. That's where we are starting today. We'll talk about it in maybe the next 25 minutes. We are done with this message. Hallelujah. But I want you to get something tonight. Your choice controls your life. Romans chapter 12, verse 2. Paul said to the people of Romans, and he's talking to us today, he said, and be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that he may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Be not conformed to the world. Be not attached to this world. Be not rooted to the world. But be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Hallelujah. Your mind has to change. When you become a born again, it does not change your body. Hallelujah. Some people that think when you become a born again, your totality will change. You will be different. You will still look, if you are tall, you will still be tall. If you have a heavy voice, your voice will still be heavy. But what has changed? Your mentality has changed. Your mental picture in life is your actual future. What you think about, what you see in your mind is what you are. And you have to start to see good things. Paul said, be not conformed to the world. Don't hook your mind, your mindset to the things that you can see. He said, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Hallelujah. He said that he may prove that is good and acceptable and perfect will of God. You have to prove it in your mind. Born again is a mindset. When your mind is transformed, you are a new person. What you can see is what controls you. I told you about mentality. Your mentality is your method in life. You know, people say, oh, he does like this, because that is where the mind is focused on. Your mentality is your method. Your mental picture, what you can see with your mind, is your actual future in life. Some people can be in abundance and they see poverty. Every time they see poverty, they will become poor. I'm telling you, there's no two ways. You don't need to pray about it because their mind is poor. They are physically wealthy. They will end up to be poor because the mind is what controls the life.
Yeah.
Choice. The devil can suggest things to your mind and you decide not to believe it. What are you seeing? Elisha looked at the man of God. They were praying. And the king said, come down. And the man of God asked his boy, say, go and look. He said, what did you see? He said, I saw nothing but just a little cloud. Small cloud. And Elisha told Gehazi, tell the king to run. Because it's going to rain, abundant rain. Hallelujah. You might not see any big thing happening, but you just see a little bit of opportunity in life. Say, oh, this thing looks like something good is going to happen to me. You feel it, but you don't know how it's going to happen. That is it. You don't need to see big, because the great things in life come in a small package. God said, don't neglect the days of little beginning. He said, though your beginning might be small, but your end shall greatly increase. Anything that starts small, grow. God would have fallen down from heaven and said, thou is Jesus Christ. And the world will come down. People want to see things. I was talking to us in the morning about, if we want to excite the world now, we can play around with a little bit of thousands of dollars and we start to do things here and get some known musicians and be playing, and we go and rent a big place, and if we have that money to keep up that thing, every day thousands of people will be struggling to park in the parking lot because some of them are not physically coming to be part of the church. They know that casting crowd is playing here. Hallelujah. Or some people will say, oh, TD Jakes is going to be here tonight, and they're coming, and people go to an organization for different reasons. Even the people that were with Jesus did not even believe in him. They were hanging around him because they can feed themselves free. They don't pay rent anymore. different reasons until something personally happened unto them. They now say, oh wow, he's God. For real, we didn't even know we are hanging out with God all this time. He said, truly you are the son of God. Choice in life is what controls your life. Destiny. Everything is bent onto your choice. Your choice to be significant is greater, much far than the choice to be successful. Because every time we focus on success, it can lead you to sin. It can lead you to cut corners. It can lead you to kill somebody. You don't have conscience no more. Because you are driven by that success. Until you get to get that in money, you cannot go down. You will be fighting tooth and nail. But if you are just out there saying, I want to make somebody be good. I want to affect humanity. Success will come. You don't need to think about it. I was telling us today about the church of Philippians when me and Mr. Leroy in the first service in the morning, and God brought that up. I'm going to read it and for you to see this church were the smallest, one of the smallest churches that Paul established. And Paul left them. Philippians chapter 4. Let's go there. Come on, God is just taking us wild this morning. God is taking us everywhere. Hallelujah. Philippians chapter 4. Paul was talking about these people. They made the choice to be successful. The church of Corinthians was one of those big churches. Church like church in the downtown, big cities. Church, a mega church. But the Philippian church were one of the smallest church that Paul saw. They were poor people. They were nobodies. They were just laymen. They were just trying to do the right thing. But they later became one of the greatest church that Paul has preached in. When Paul saw them the next time, Paul said, wow, these people have been great because of character. Because they were sold, not to the man of God, but they were sold to the gospel. They believed God absolutely. They didn't have any reservation. They have the choice to go otherwise, but they refused. Look at what Paul started to say. It's a lengthy verse we are going to read this morning. I will start from verse 3. Paul was writing to the people of Philippians in Philippians chapter 4, verse 3. He said, I entreat thee also through yoke followers, help those women which labor with me in the gospel, with Clement also, and with others, my fellow laborers, whose names are in the book of life. Verse 4. He said, rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice. He said, let your moderation be known unto all men. The Lord is at hand. Hallelujah. Verse 6. He said, be careful for nothing. Many of us are so careful to many, many things. We are trying to make sure it is right before we do it. He said, be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your request be known unto God. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, shall keep your heart and mind through Christ Jesus. Look at verse 8. He said, finally, brethren, whatsoever thing is true. That means, look at where you are going to focus your heart these days. Whatsoever thing is true, whatsoever thing are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are good, of good report. If there be any virtue, and if there be any praise, think of these things. Paul is trying to change their mindset. He said, cloud yourself with every good thing. Think about them, because your thoughts is your life. Verse 9, he said, those things which you have both learned, received and heard and seen in me, do, and the God of peace shall be with thee. He said, but I rejoice in the Lord greatly, that now at least your care of me have flourished again. Look at the word, your care of me. And Paul will analyze what he's saying now. He said, but he lacked opportunities. Not that I speak in respect of want, but I have learned in whatsoever state I am, therewith to be content. As a man of God, you have to have integrity. He said, I know both how to be abased and I know how to abound. Everywhere and in all things, I am instructed by both to be full and to be hungry, both to abound and to suffer need. I can do all things through Christ that strengthened me. Notwithstanding, ye have well done that ye did communicate with me with my affliction. You people are the ones that communicated with me. Look at what he said in verse 15. He said, now ye Philippians know also that in the beginning of the gospel, when I departed from Macedonia, no church communicated with me as concerning giving and receiving, but ye only. He said, for even in Thessalonica, ye sent once again unto my necessities. Not because I desire a gift, but I desire fruit that may abound to your account. But I have all and abound. I am full, having received of Epaphroditus the things which were sent from you, an odor of a sweet smell, a sacrifice acceptable, pleasing to God. And he said that thing he said in verse 19. Everybody says that. People don't know why Paul went there. He said, but my God shall supply all your needs according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. The church of Philippians met the need of the man of God. Not because they were compelled to do that. Not because they were pressured to do it. But because they loved God. Paul was not in Philippians by then. Paul has gone away. Everywhere Paul is traveling, they will send him gifts, send him cap. They know his birthday. They know about his family. They know everything about him. Paul said, what is this? I don't even need this. If you go down, look at the people that were hanging out with Paul. Paul was not trying to tell them, come on. It's not that I was in need, but you guys have done something that no church has done. Let's go down. He said, but my God shall, after we have read it, verse 20, he said, now unto God our Father to glory forever and ever. Amen. He says, salute every saint in Christ Jesus. The brethren which are with me greets you. And he started to say, who are those that are with? He said, all the saints salute you. Chiefly, they that are of Caesar's household. Caesar was the greatest man on earth. He was like President Obama. Paul was hanging out with the people in the palace. He said, chiefly, they that are in Caesar's household. He said, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen. He's writing this letter to the church of Philippians. Of what they have done, this is a choice. He said, among all the churches, you are the only one that communicated with me again and again, not once. You keep sending gifts, you keep asking after me, you keep... This church planted every church from Corinthians to Philippians to Galatians to Thessalonica to Colossians to Hebrew. All these are churches that Paul met. Every time he planted a church, he moved on. He's an apostle. But the church of Philippians were the poorest. They were a very small church, but they loved God. They chose to be associated to big things, and they became big. God increased them, and they became one of the greatest churches that Paul has ever planted. The church of Philippians. The church of the Corinthians was a big church. Psychedelic church. The church in the city, in Wall Street, where people that has money are. But they don't care about nothing. They were just socializing in church. Paul looked at them and said, this is not what I have told you people. The church of Galatians, they move with any wind. Anybody that comes, if this prophet is here today, they say, oh wow, this prophet is great. Another prophet comes, they say, that prophet is this. Paul said, oh Galatians, who has bewitched you? Why have you people changed? You are toasted with all kinds of doctrines. Some say we are of Apollos. Some say we are of Paul. They were dividing the church in Galatians. Paul said, no. Who has bewitched you? Who has changed your mindset? This is not what God preached. Your choice controls your life. I'm going to tell you about a man before we leave now that decided not to stay in myopicness, in smallness, and became one of the greatest prophets in the Bible. Hallelujah. And we are going to talk about people here on earth. We are going to make references to men that God have used and women that have decided to make the right thing happen. Let's go to the Bible. Hallelujah. And see this man known as Elisha. Hallelujah. 2 Kings chapter 2. Elisha was the greatest prophet in his time. The book of 2 Kings, chapter 2, hallelujah, and verse 15. This is when Elijah was about to leave. God has called Elijah to come back home. And there were other people that were serving alongside Elijah. And there were men of God that were there then. But they decided to view where things are happening. Brethren, every time you see the pool of God, jump into it. Never you wait for God to come and meet you, because you might lose that opportunity. Look at verse 15. He said, and when the sons of the prophet which were to view at Jericho saw him. These guys were viewing. The sons of prophet, they were pastors in training. They were 400 something of them. They said, the spirit of Elijah does rest on Elisha. And they came to meet with him and bowed themselves to the ground before him. And they said unto him, behold, now there be with thy servant 50 strong men. Let them go, we pray thee, and seek thy master, lest peradventure the spirit of the Lord had taken him up and cast him upon some mountains or into some valley. And he said, ye shall not send. Hallelujah. This is the same man. I'm going to give you the narrative of what happened here. Elisha made a choice not to view when he knew that Elijah was about to leave him. He followed Elijah. And Elijah will tell him, wait here, let me go and see what the Lord wants me to do. He will say no. And the Bible says, if you start to read from verse 1, the sons of prophet were following them also, but they were standing like 2 or 3 miles. Let's see what is going to happen. And they were the same people that came back and told Elijah, said, do you know that your master is going to leave you today? Haven't you been in a place and people know that the house is going to be foreclosed and they are starting to make up stories, laughing at you? People know that you are losing something. Maybe your husband left you or somebody died in your family, and they start to chastise you with that. They were chastising Elisha. Say, do you know that your master will leave you today? And Elisha will tell them, hold that peace. Look at what Elijah told Elisha in verse 2. He said, and Elijah said unto Elisha, tarry here, I pray thee, for the Lord has sent me to Bethel. And Elisha said unto him, as the Lord liveth and as thy soul liveth, I will not leave thee. So they went down to Bethel. And the sons of the prophet that were in Bethel came forth to Elisha and said unto him, knowest thou that the Lord will take away thy master from thy head today? And as he said, yeah, I know it. Hold your peace. Do you know that your master is leaving you today? You used to ride with him in limousine. You are his right-hand man. But he's going to leave you today. You will be poor. They are making mockery of him. He said, I know about it. Don't worry. Hold your peace. People know about negative information, things that are happening. They say, do you know that by tomorrow you don't have a house again? He told them, don't worry, I know. Take your time. Just hold your peace. And he kept following. And Elijah will tell you, wait here. God said, I should go there and say, or as long as the God lives, I will follow you. I will go with you. At the time, he looked at him and said, can I have double portion of what you have? Elijah looked at him and said, that is zealous. He said, I can't give you. But if you can see me, that is the key point. What are you seeing right now? If you can see me enter, you will get it. And he kept following him. And as they were going from city to city, a lot of people were following also, but they were viewing from far. And they came over to Jordan. And Elijah told Elisha to wait. Elisha refused. He made a choice, said, I'm going with you. And what did Elijah do? Elijah took his apron, his mantle, and his mat on the water. And the water opened up, and there was an expressway. They didn't have a boat, and both of them walked on the soil and crossed. And the sons of prophets, instead of them crossing over with them, that was when the miracle took place. You cannot be in a pool of power and you lose out. They would have crossed over. They stood on the other side and was viewing them and probably gossiping about it. And when they crossed, the water came back together. And they said, let's see how he's going to die today. He will be left there. And when the chariot of fire came down and took Elijah, Elisha was looking and looking. I don't know what was going on in his mind. Because the master did not give him a very good answer. He said, give me what you have. He said, I can't give it to you, but if you can see me, you might get it. It's a 50-50 thing. It's a probability. But he desired that ability. He desired that power. He made a choice. Said, this man, even though if he die, I will die with him. I'm going to be with you wherever you go. And when the power of God came and took him, he was watching him. Just as he's about to enter the cloud, the Bible says his apron fell down. And Elisha watched the mountain fell down. And he went and picked it up. He didn't know he has power yet. And he was coming back, maybe crying, saying, oh, my master has left me. And what am I going to do? All these pastors, the church will be scattered. Everything will fall apart. He came to Jordan and looked at the water. He said, where is the God of Elijah? He hit it there and the water opened it to him. And that day he knew he got power. The Bible says, as he was walking out from Jordan, and the sons of prophets that are supposed to receive the same kind of ability, they saw him. They said, the spirit of Elijah has gone into Elisha. And all of them bowed down to him. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Choice is what makes a man. And he became the leader of the church. Before that time, he was nobody. He was just a regular guy. He was a guy that has zeal in the church. Everything they said, do, he will be the first person to do it. And they're looking at him, what are you doing this thing? Elijah will be gone in a moment, and you will not have any royalty anymore. Royalty will be gone with you. But he made a choice to stay and wait upon God. Mary Magdalene was one of those strong women, people of our time. She decided to continue to go to the tomb. The first day she went there and embalmed the Lord. You know what happened before Jesus died? She poured the alabaster oil and the perfume was everywhere. And Peter looked at him and said, what is this woman doing in church? Not only being here, she is in the feet of the master. And they were grumbling in their heart. And Jesus looked at them and said, anywhere the gospel is preached, talk about this woman. Because she understands the time. And they didn't know what Jesus was saying until Jesus died. The woman was sold to the ministry. She was sold to God. She kept going back even in the grave. And the day Jesus rose, because of her faith and attachment to the power of God, she refused the master to get into heaven. She saw Jesus before God. Hallelujah. The Bible said that Jesus came back and told her, and said, Mary, I have not seen my father and your father. He said, but go back to the apostles and told them that I've risen. Even Peter. Because Jesus mentioned Peter's name because the last encounter with Peter was not good. When he turned and Peter denied him. That was the last encounter with Peter. Peter went back, thought he was not saved anymore. But Jesus reassured Mary, said, go and tell my apostles that I have risen, even Peter. Hallelujah. And she was the one that brought the good news. But all the thing that she was doing before that time, they thought that this prostitute, what is she doing in church? Why is she always coming to the pastor? Why is she always the one in the office? She was keep coming, giving gifts, bringing food, buying clothes, bringing perfumes, doing all these things. The disciples were angry with her. If my Lord knew who this woman was, that's what Peter thought. He would not let her come even close to him. Because they saw demons leave this girl the day Jesus was praying for her. The Bible says 7 demons left her. Hallelujah. And Jesus used that woman as an analogy. He told him about a man that had 2 people owing him. One person was owing bigger money. And the other person was owing nothing. Like somebody's owing $1 million to you. And somebody's owing you $10. And both of them come crying that they don't have the money. And you ask them to go. And he asked them, who will be more appreciative to that man? And everybody said, the man that owed more. That woman was that man. She has done so much bad thing. And God forgave her. She was so appreciative. But Peter and them think maybe we just told a couple of lies and we got saved. So they don't really see it as if they owe that so much to God. Hallelujah. That's why their belief system was low. Choice is everything. A man we know here in America, Abraham Lincoln, he ran from Chicago. He ran all election. Ran for the state house, failed. Ran for senate in the state, failed. Ran for council, he failed. Ran for mayor, he failed. Ran for everything, but he ran for president. And became the 16th president of America. He made a choice not to be a failure. Everybody told him it's over. Every time his name is on the ballot box, people say, Abraham Lincoln again. What is he doing here? He ran last time, he failed. Why is he running again? And they will go and cast the vote. And this man became so popular that he became like a virus. Everybody knew about him. You know, there's a time that things will happen to you perpetually. It becomes a stigma. So now, everywhere he appeared, people see failure in him. But they didn't know that he would be one of the greatest presidents of this country. He made a choice not to remain what the devil said. He went back and did it again. And did it big and became the 16th president of America. Life is choice. We talked about Nelson Mandela this morning. He had a choice. When they made a deal with him, say, okay, go back and do your business. We are not going to talk about you or disturb you. But don't ever fight about this thing again. He refused. Mandela was not poor, even during apartheid. He was a successful lawyer. He was very intelligent. He had money. But he made a choice not to stay for himself. He wanted to be significant, not to be successful. And he suffered for 27 years, paid the price. Many times, the world leaders will make a meeting and say, okay, Mandela, if you go to sign this document, you will never mention this thing. You just go back and he said, no, I'd rather stay here and die. Instead of me going for the people to suffer. We know about Dr. King. He was very successful. He got Oscar. He got everything. He was a preacher. He was a doctor. You know, he had eloquence. He had people following him. He had money. He had influence. He had, for him, for you to win Oscar in his time, in the 60s, you must be a different species. Because the world is not balanced then. Hallelujah. Not now. In this time, anybody can win that thing. But he got all these things. He made a choice not to settle. Many times, many of us in life, we settle. We don't want to be in that job. But because that's the only thing that they're offering us, we settle with that. And tomorrow you complain that you didn't make it because you chose not to make it. Life is a choice. What is your choice tonight? The devil will always offer you things to keep you bound. But sometimes the highway is not the best way. You got to go through the rough roads. You got to go through some things, stuff. And most times when you are going through those things, it's not because you are not doing the right thing, but because God wants to get the best out of you. The Bible said the children of God, God told them about the land. We read it in the prayer line last night. God told them about where they are going to be. Show them, tell them how and what is going to be there. But what happened? They have to battle for every city. Hallelujah. Every town, they have to take it by fire and by force. They went into battle to get everything they got. Was God not in it? God was in it. But God wants them to appreciate those things. Many times, the things that we get in life is not about the things that we see. Because if everybody wants to be something, you might just go and look for a job and they say, okay, we have this job, it's $5, $10, $9, $15, $20, whatever. And you go and settle with the one that is available. Instead of saying, okay, I need this $20 job or $15 or $30 per hour. And they say, well, we have the slot for two people and it was already taken. You tell them, this is what I need. If you get that kind of job, call me. And you go back and people say, are you a fool? Why not take the one of $5 first and start from there and work your way up? There is no way up. Many times when you go into a job, it's a dead zone. You can't see no place. The glass ceiling is closed. You are just caged in wherever you are. No way. Working your way up is no more visible right now. Because everything you settle for, that's why you see a lot of young men, managers in different companies, will get out of school with their MBA and they go into a company and they give them some entry position. Say, don't worry. When you enter, we can promote you. After 2 years, they quit. Because they see that there's no promotion. They just keep you there, bam. Many of them will quit and suffer more before they can get to what they want. Some of them will go and start their own business, start their own job, start their own internet business, or whatever, and grow from there because the choice to be successful is very, very tempting. The devil always presents that to you. Jesus Christ had a choice. The devil came to him and said, if you can bow down to me, I'll give you the whole world. Hallelujah. How can the devil offer God what he has already had? Many times the thing that we settle for is what we already have. What you already have, you don't even know you have it in the spirit. And you go and settle. And God will say, why are you settling? Come on, fight more. I still need you to push further. Because you can be better than what you are right now. Hallelujah. You have to go and get the better. God is not calling us to just take the status quo, to take anything. The devil cannot throw anything at you and you say yes and take it. Sometimes you have to fight back. Not physically, but in the spirit. Paul said, be not conformed to the world, but be you transformed by the renewing of your mind. Paul was that kind of man. He would have said, okay, I've done so much. Oh, when he saw the church of Corinthians, he would have settled and become their pastor. After all, the tithe and offering would take care of him. He refused to stay there. He kept moving on. He said, I have learned to be abode and to be abased. I've learned to be hungry and to be satisfied. I've learned to live in a palace and to live in a ground. So I don't get moved by those things. Hallelujah. I have learned to adapt to any condition in life. That is the mindset of a man that will succeed in life. Every time you see somebody traveling with a bag, they are coming back. Hallelujah. If you see people going with a lot of luggages and baggages, their journey is very, very long. Hallelujah. If you want to know a man that is going to be long in his journey, check his baggage. How many bags does he have? Because he's going to pack more food, more clothes, more shoes, because he knows that he's going to be long in that journey. But every time you see people, the seculars, they come in today, tomorrow they are gone. They walk in right now, the next day you don't see them again. They disappear like a wind. That is how the job that also the devil present to us. It come with flashy. It come with nice things. And once you go in, you are out. The day you are entering, you are the exit is already open for you. Hallelujah. So by the time you enter, you are already out. You didn't know about it. But things that will become big in life, you work it out. Paul said, faith is work. He said, work out your salvation. Work it out. You don't need to settle, brethren. I'm telling you this today. Your choice is what controls your destiny. You don't need to allow the devil to inflict negativity upon you. Even when the devil has thrown all these things on you, you just have to brush it off and move on. Hallelujah. And become who God has created you to be. Praise the Lord. Life is choice. In the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Paul talked in Romans chapter 8. We are going to read that. He said, courage is the ability to do what is right, even in the midst of opposition. When you have courage, it's not that you are different, but the ability to say, well, this thing is good, but I'm not going to do it. I'm going to do the right thing. Because sometimes everything that is good in the eyes of a man is not what is good in the eyes of everybody. Romans chapter 8, and we are going to end with that now. Romans chapter 8, verse 11. I want you to understand who you are in the presence of God. Romans 8, 11. Paul was talking to us. He said, if the Holy Spirit is the same Spirit that raised Jesus Christ from death, how far can that Spirit not do much more for us? I want you to see it in black and white. If you have seen it, say, I am there. 8:11. Are we there? Yes, sir. He said, but if the Spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwells in you. Hallelujah. He said, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal body by his Spirit that dwelt in you. Yes, sir. Therefore, brethren, we are debtors, not to the flesh, to live after the flesh. If you live after the flesh, ye shall die. But if ye, through the Spirit, do mortify the deeds of the body, ye shall live. He said, for as many as are led by the Spirit, they are the sons of God. That means we are not going to keep to what we see. Paul said, if you believe in Jesus and that same Spirit that went and raised him from the dead is in you, that Spirit can do great things with you. Many times we say we are believers, but we still have resentment. We have reservation. We don't really throw ourselves in to the bowl for God to use us. Make the right choice today. And the Lord will lead you into the right path. In the name of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Holy Spirit. I just want you to stand on your feet. Father, we thank you. We worship you. Hallelujah. The choice to be significant is greater than the choice to be successful. Life is a choice. Father, we thank you. We worship you right now. We exalt, we magnify you. We glorify, we adore you for everything. Have your way, O Lord. Give us the Spirit to make the right choice, even in the mix of opposition. Because the devil will always fight to hinder the children of God from becoming who you have called them to be. But today we stand with the word of God. David said, I would rather be a security, a doorkeeper in the house of God, than to be a king among the wicked. I would rather sit in church as the usher or the security people outside than to be a king among wicked people, because they can kill you in a moment. They can say, oh, you are the king today. The next day your head is off. But if I'm in the house of God as a security, I'm better off. It was a choice he made to worship God in season and out of season. He became the greatest king that have lived. God said, every king will die, but King David will never die. A choice. Life is choice. What choice have you made today? What had the devil shown you in your life? I want you to talk to God. It's a time of a sober reflection. Just talk to God in your own way. Ask God to give you the power to make the right choice. Like Mary Magdalene, she did not think about herself, but think about the kingdom. Paul sold himself, walked everywhere, walked for God. I told you about Elijah. Followed Elijah until he got it. In the name of Jesus Christ, life is choice. The choice you make today will control your tomorrow. Your future is in your choices. In the name of Jesus Christ, we thank you, Lord, Father, for the opportunity that are open in the future in our lives. We thank you for the grace of God. And to those of you that will listen to this program in the future, your life depends on your choices. In Jesus' mighty name we pray.